Hi there, I'm Clifford Hartleigh Low, and this is Spellbound, Love Magic Through the Ages. For those of you who can, I recommend that you take notes. There's a lot of material to go through. This is a dense and intense topic. I have lectured on a lot of things at ConVocation before. I've never tried my hand at love magic. I've certainly done a fair amount in real life, but I thought it would be fun to explain the history of love magic and my perspectives on it. In order to understand the topic of love magic, you have to understand the topic of love itself, because people do not agree what love is. Plato tried to address this in his Symposium, and he came to a variety of contradictory conclusions in this seminal text, that love is a seeking after perfection, an aspiration towards virtue and completeness, but also an indication that we are flawed, fundamentally and incomplete, that we are mediocre beings driven by lust and aspirations towards a false immortality. Later on in history, Andreas Capellanus wrote in The Art of Courtly Love, which was the foundation of the notion of chivalry and romantic love, that amor comes from amus, a hook. Love is a seduction, is a deceit, and tries to get under your skin. That love is a desire after beauty, inner or outer. That fidelity is less valuable than discretion. He was a big advocate, strangely, of cheating. He believed that love was like war, and the lover is like a warrior, and that secret love is the best love of all. He said that love is a longing, and though he didn't coin the phrase all's fair in love and war, he might have. His attitude was that love was too important to have too many scruples about it. Later on, Renaissance humanism tried to combine these two attitudes and believed that love, cosmic eros, is what joins all reality together, and it is the true form of magic. It joins high and low magic. High magic, which joins forces of benevolence and divinity, and low magic in the form of seduction and love spells. Love redeems imperfect forms of desire, as all desire, even the worst, seeks perfection underneath the surface. The Greek notion was more skeptical of erotic love than Plato, but the Renaissance humanist notion was all about the positivity of love. The next phase of our attitude about love comes from modernity and the idea of natural instincts being the drive towards love. It brought to us the idea that love is chemistry, that pheromones control us, that neurotransmitters are a conduit for love or the actual mechanism of love. We can't overestimate the role of Freud in anthropology in the incorporation of sexuality into love magic and our notions of love in general. They discovered that the so-called primitive tribes would have very sexualized totems that looked like penises and vaginas and breasts. And out of this, in the 19th century, came the notion of genital worship. Genital worship was one of the ingredients in the stew which became Wicca and modern paganism. It introduced a materiality of love. It introduced the concept of love as a kind of energy, whose energy is a materialistic concept at its basis. This idea flourished in the work of Anton Mesmer, who wrote about animal magnetism and used it to found an early version of hypnosis and also to engage in vaguely sexual activities. This fed into the work of Pascal Beverly Randolph, who was a pioneer of sex magic. And this, in turn, led into the work of Aleister Crowley and the OTO, which literally sexualized magic and saw sex magic as the primary energy source for magical will actualizing in reality. In the end, love magic is a sprawl of contrasting ideas, because our beliefs about love include the best ideals and the darkest impulses. Love's magic is that it can be felt yet never fully understood. Now, our goals is to describe different types of love magic, and there's a vague progression to them in the progression of a theoretical relationship. Now, the ideal relationship is one that never ends, but we will be covering breakup magic, so that is a part of the process of a relationship which breaks down, and reconciliation, which deals with what happens after the relationship ends and you want it to begin again. So the process here is the first stage is libido. You have to have sexual appetite or desire to be with someone. Not everybody has sexual appetite. Some people don't want it, some people do. That's the first stage. Then there is, let's see, beauty and glamour magic. Magic which makes you attractive to people. You may not seek a mate, but you want to be a desirable person. Magic which improves your appearance is the second stage. The third is love attraction, when you don't have a specific mate in mind, but you want to be appealing to a particular type of person. The next stage is targeted seduction or coercive love magic, one of the more controversial ones. Then there's passion magic, magic which takes an ordinary relationship which might be tepid and makes it fiery and very, very sexual. And there's keeping and binding magic. If you're in a relationship which is beginning to fall apart, this is a way of forcing your lover or your spouse to stay with you, or making it more pleasant to be around that person. The next stage, as I mentioned before, is breakup magic. Breakup curses are a type of love magic. They're just a mirror image of it. And finally, there's reconciliation magic, which after a relationship is ended, if you want to bring your lover back to you, that is another form of love magic. There's also a general category of love magic spells, which don't really fit into any category, or materials which can be used in a wide variety of them. Now, when you investigate love magic throughout history, you see a lot of core metaphors. They're usually sensory metaphors, which appear over and over and over again throughout all the sympathetic magic, and largely love magic is sympathetic magic, not exclusively. The first metaphor you see a lot is burning, the fire of love, the heart that is aflame. And so a lot of things get burned in love magic. There's sweetening, things involving sweet scents or sweet flavors, sugar, honey, flower petals, fragrances and perfumes, floral notes, all of these are associated with love magic. There's also, particularly with regards to puppets, penetrating imagery and breaking imagery. It's usually not sexual penetration that can happen. It's often breaking into a cold heart as a way of forcing someone who is unsympathetic towards you to like you. Another set of imagery which recurs is joining, like taking two wax dolls and melting them together, or two wax hearts and melting them together. And joining is another core metaphor in love magic. And trapping also is common. For example, the use of cobwebs as an ingredient to ensnare a lover. Contrasting also appears, fire and water, dark and light, as a way of signifying the polarity which appears in many sexual relationships, not necessarily gender. And then there are the negative metaphors which appear, souring, bitter tastes, bad flavors, and bad scents, severing, cutting things, breaking things up, and clashing, like as will recur in this lecture, dog hair and cat hair, fighting like cats and dogs. I will be covering, to the best possible extent, five different traditions which I'm most familiar with. I could cover more, but we don't have the time. I will be covering a little bit of ancient Greek love magic. I will be covering a very small amount of my favorite scholastic image magic, or the magic of talismans, which will be related to my class immediately after this, Magic of the Lunar Mansions. Ancient Jewish folk magic, which is not quite Kabbalah. Solomonic magic, and an absolute shitload of hoodoo. African or hoodoo or conjure.
Because you can't have that conversation without hoodoo.
Yeah, hoodoo is fun. All right, let's start with general love stuff. If you're doing a love spell, most people go to a higher power first and foremost because love is sacred. And if you aren't sure about your own judgment or how to achieve a particular effect, you call upon a god of love. There is no comprehensive list of gods of love, but here's a few starters. Eros, Anteros, Aphrodite, Ishtar, Hathor, Matsu, Amaterasu, Friga, Oshun, Azili Freda, St. Valentine, who could be in a pagan context interpreted as a god, and similarly St. Martha the Dominator, St. Cyprian, the god Priapus, and Pambagira. Other common ingredients that we see in love spells are herbs for love. And these are mostly hoodoo herbs, but they do recur in medieval love magic and many other traditions, like Adam and Eve root, basil, which is sacred to Azili Freda, cinnamon, because it spices up love, red clover, cloves, I love cloves. I love smoking cloves. I don't smoke cloves anymore. Damiana, dill, ginger, jasmine, lavender, mistletoe, tonka beans, nutmeg, patchouli, red and pink roses, rose otto, which is a scent, and sometimes flowers from a wedding are used, orris root, and here's some other things which are used in love spells which are non-herbal, arrowheads because they are phallic symbols, baculums, which are bones which appear in the penises of various animals like raccoons and so forth. Cowrie shells are used to symbolize labia and are often used to represent a female subject of a love spell. Venus talismans are used from a variety of traditions that relate to the planetary magics, and pentacles from the Solomonic tradition are usually for love magic. Candles, red candles are for passion. This is mostly hoodoo symbolism, but sometimes is adapted to Wicca and other traditions. Red is for passion, love. Pink is for romantic love. Black is for breakups. Green or blue is to propitiate Venus. And yellow or black is for domination, love domination, to force someone to love you. The ancient Greeks seemed to favor the idea of eonxes, which were their idea of prayer wheels. They would put the image of the person on the prayer wheel, and supposedly this was invented by Aphrodite, and spin the image of the person to disorient them and to seduce them. They also used catadesmoi, which are defixios, I think, in Latin. And these are lead sheets where the effigy of the target would be inscribed and a variety of bindings placed upon them. And sometimes their hearts would be pierced to injure them or to cause them the pangs of love to seduce the target. The ancient Greeks used potions, which they called pharmaka. Pharmaka turned into pharmacy and pharmaceuticals. And they really were obsessed with usia. These are understood in the Western magical tradition as relics and in hoodoo as personal concerns. If you couldn't get the usia of someone, you probably couldn't do a love spell upon them in ancient Greece. Greek love magic is also very hard to distinguish from aphrodisiacs, because a love potion and an aphrodisiac are only distinguished ultimately by the principle by which it operates, whether it's chemistry or something symbolic and magical. Other elements which appear frequently in love magic are wedding rings and sugar and honey, but I mentioned that already, so I'll be out of order. All right, this is the dicey section. All right, ethics. We will be covering coercive or directed love magic, and this is a tough topic. I'll tell you my opinion in this little section here, which I wrote out carefully. Feel free to disagree with me on this one. I don't use a lot of coercive love magic, but I won't say that I've never done it. Let me read this. For something nearly everybody wants, love is controversial and perilous. Love magic is even more so. Much of this material comes from an era when people had very little control over their lives. Consent, when available, was usually only a choice between masters. Marriages were usually arranged. Directed love spells were often attempts to convince someone to break an oath rather than to ignite passion unnaturally. Yet other spells inspired attraction, but not necessarily consummation. The way we use these methods can define us as moral agents in a world that is both different but similar in some other ways. Traditional societies often had strict hierarchies where everyone above you could do as they willed all the way down. Today we are bombarded by influences in media, culture, and gender roles, which are just as manipulative as any love spell. We have an illusion that we are independent and free, but influences, both mystical and mundane, vie to control us at every moment. This is a kind of black magic that is around us, that we have normalized. Love magic is not normalized, but perhaps it should be. Rather than thinking of it as artificial, I urge you to try to think of it as the most authentic love. It is of a sacred and divine nature, a gift of the gods. It deserves a little respect. Letting more love and magic into this desacralized world might be an inherent good, even in its many imperfect forms. I do not advocate coercive love magic, but we live in a world of grays, not black and white. We can often find happiness and safety in those shadows between. The old saying is that all's fair in love and war. Neither are true, but the myth has a basis in fact, as we shall see. All practical magic is unfair, but the rules set in place are not fair either. They don't favor you. You probably were meant to lose or meant to settle for far less than you deserve, about one thing or other. So breaking those rules of convention, those corrupt norms, might not be entirely unpardonable. Effective magic is not about stealing power but taking power back. Corrupt systems virtually demand hacking. Virility magic. Most of this is applicable to males, but some of it is applicable to females. If you bathe in dill, it will restore your virility. High John the Conqueror chips in oil placed on the penis restores lost nature or virility. Mustard seed restores virility. Samson snake root also restores virility. You take a buckeye nut and you oil it next to your nose, here and here, and that restores virility when you carry it in your pocket next to your genitals. Yes?
Specifically, are you defining virility as the ability to impregnate someone or as your own sexual potency?
Libido.
Libido. Okay.
Yes. There are lots of different terms for that, but for now, okay, I'll call it libido.
Right. All right.
Burdock root and olive oil on the penis does the same. Ginseng and holy oil to anoint the penis does the same. If there's a more complicated recipe that I got from my friend Kat Ironwood, who runs LuckyMojo.com, shout out to Kat. You take Arm & Hammer baking soda and saltpeter and yellow mustard powder, and you mix it while you chant, remove the evil spirits from this body. And you take 4 tablespoons of this and 1 gallon of water, and you wash this down your body on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and by Friday it's done, and you are healed of your impotence or the impotence curse that's been placed upon you.
Excuse me, the name of the website again?
LuckyMojo.com. You take juniper berries and steep that in whiskey for a month, and you sip that to restore your libido. All right, next topic, attractiveness. The Greeks actually had a word for this type of spell. They called it the charitasium. If you take catnip, it makes women attractive to men. High John the Conqueror root makes men studly and powerful to women and to men who are inclined towards such. Knotweed in the tea of your intended will make you seem more attractive to them. Attractiveness spells can also be thought of as glamours, by the way. All right, love drawing magic. This is not to direct the love magic, but to attract someone new into your life that is compatible with you. Damiana draws a new lover. If you take ash tree leaves, red clover, rosebuds, lavender, and attraction oil, and you put it into a pink mojo, that will draw you a new lover if you carry it on you. If you chew cardamom at a gathering or a party, that will draw you a new lover. If you mix catnip with your menstrual blood, assuming you have menstrual blood, and sprinkle it around the 4 corners of your bed, it will get you a man, assuming you want a man. Witch grass attracts a new lover. Cubeb peppers in a bath will draw a new lover. And here's a recipe for a men's jackball. This is to get a date. It's primarily used for heterosexual males trying to find a heterosexual female. You take a pair of lodestone, masculine and feminine lodestones. Masculine lodestones are vaguely phallic in shape or angular. Feminine lodestones are flat or spherical. You take 2 small lodestones which attract each other, masculine and feminine, presumably for a man seeking a female, but you can alter the spell slightly for lesbian and gay relationships. And you bind it together with gentian, bohog root, John the Conqueror chips into a wax ball, and you wrap it up with red thread, and you tie it off with 9 knots. And you anoint this with John the Conqueror oil or nature oil, and you carry it on you when you go out on the town, and you will get lucky.
How would you modify it for LGBT relationships?
I would replace the John the Conqueror root chips with orris root for lesbian relationships, for lesbian relationships, you would probably want 2 female lodestones. And if you were doing it for a gay relationship, you would want to have 2 male lodestones. You could still use the John the Conqueror chips for that one.
An additional question. You were talking about some of the herbs like catnip, but you didn't say what to do with them.
Well, they can be used in lots of different ways. They can be used to dress a candle. They can be put into a bath. They can put them into a mojo bag. They can be used, if they're safe to do so, in a potion. They can be used in a tea, and you can spread the tea around your home. You can use it in the floor wash. A lot of hoodoo herbs can be used in lots of different modalities. The only limit is your imagination. Mm-hmm. Let's see, what's next? All right, back to the lodestones. Another really great way to draw a new lover, and I have used this myself fairly successfully, is to take two larger lodestones, and for me, a male lodestone, which is named after me, and a female lodestone, which is named after an abstraction of love, my desired one. And you baptize them, you give them your name and the desired one's name, and you put them on an altar. What I do is actually I use a red saucer, that's what I do. And I feed them iron filings and move them closer and closer together with each passing week. And once they've moved together and I have begun the new relationship, I take these paired lodestones and I put them underneath my bed where I would be having sex with that new relationship and keep it under there and keep feeding there for as long as the relationship is to last. Now you can use that very same technique by naming both of the lodestones to attract a particular person. That's the next section. If you bathe in orange flowers or use a neroli fragrance, that will draw a spouse. There's an oil that's very classic in hoodoo called Cliome, and that's used by male and female prostitutes to find rich Johns. If you take safflower petals and you burn that as an incense, that gets gay men laid. If you take the very same petals and you put them in safflower oil with Samson snake root, and you put that on your backside and the backs of your knees, that will attract a new lover, more durable than a hot night on the town. Now, violet leaf is shaped sort of like a Valentine heart, and so it's used a lot in love magic and hoodoo. You put that in one of your shoes and you walk around with that for 7 days, and that will draw you a new lover. But it's even more strong if you replace it 3 times, so you're walking around with 3 different leaves over 21 days. Now, with all these love recipes, you may want a particular type of lover. Chamomile is a herb used in hoodoo for money. So if you add chamomile into any kind of love drawing recipe, it will draw you a rich lover. It will get you a sugar daddy or sugar mommy or whatever you might want. I'm not sure how safe this is, but okay. If you steep juniper in vinegar and you douche with it, it will draw you a new lover. If you take a sachet of lavender flowers and put them in your bosom, this will draw you a new lover, male or female, as you prefer, but you have to have a bosom in order to put it there. Okay, here's a spell I stumbled upon that I didn't even realize was a spell. And this is probably the most effective love spell I've ever done. Or maybe a sex spell, let's put it that way. Around 2001, I was experimenting with feng shui. I wanted to learn about it. I wanted to learn about everything. And I read that there's a particular portion of your room, I think to the right of the entrance, which signifies love and sexual relationships. And in order to let new love into your life, you have to make it clean, and you have to put lots of red passionate things there. So what I did is I cleaned out this area of my apartment, and I put in a new lamp, and put in a red light bulb and kept that burning at all hours. And I put in a vase full of red silk flowers. And the very next day, a woman I barely knew came over to my house and gave me the best sex of my life. This wasn't intended as a spell, but this is certainly a power of intentionality and mixing with symbolism in a very highly magically charged environment like my apartment. Targeted seduction, the danger zone. Dittany of Crete, if fed to your intended, they will desire you. Juniper berries are used in seduction spells. Magnets are used like lodestones for even stronger attraction, but it feels unnatural. It feels like someone is trying to take you over, whereas lodestones feel like natural love. The iron filings that you take off of magnets, which are used in love magic, And for both lodestones and magnets are used in love spells themselves. One thing you can do is you can throw the iron filings after a person. So if you desire someone, their back is turned, you can take the iron filings and just throw it at their back, and that will make them love you. Another trick, and I've used this to a certain extent, is you take pinches of the iron filings which you've taken off the lodestones at the end of the year that they've been resting upon it, and you place it on the 4 corners of your room, of your bedroom, and put another pinch under your bed. And that will draw love to you, and anybody who sits at the edge of your bed can be seduced more easily by you. That 5-point pattern is called a quincunx, and it recurs a great deal throughout hoodoo. the classic love poppets and hoodoo, they aren't used, they aren't wax, they're usually made out of cloth, and they're filled with love herbs. So in hoodoo, poppets are filled with herbs which symbolize your intentionality. They're bound face to face with red string in the case of love. And neroli can be used, or rather orange blossoms can be used inside a love poppet to target a special intended for marriage. There's also the classic split apple spell. You've probably heard a version of this one. You cut an apple in half, you take a piece of paper, and you write your name on top and your intended at the bottom. You fold it in half, or you cut it in half so the names face each other. You seal it up with honey, and then you either bind the apple with red thread or red wax, and you bury it at the foot of a tree. So as the tree grows, your love will grow with the intended. Another similar notion are Adam and Eve roots relative to the magnets. I'm sorry, a little bit out of order. If you dress an Adam and Eve roots with Adam and Eve oil and love me powder, and you name them after the two subjects of the spell, you place them on a large mirror and about 7 inches apart. After the new moon ends, and you move them incrementally closer every night until they touch each other on the night of the full moon. And much like the magnets and the lodestones, it will draw the person you desire towards you. And then there's the classic eaten corn spell. Everyone says this is gross. This is gross. It's been done, however, for thousands of years. You take a indigestible thing, like a corn granule or a dried bean, and you swallow it, and it passes through your system. And you, hopefully with rubber gloves, pick it out of your feces and wash it thoroughly, and you cook it and you feed it to your intended, and they'll be seduced by you. Yeah. It is totally gross. I would never do that. Yeah. Ever, 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 ever. Yeah. Well, but it's so old and it appears in so many different cultures, it is worth mentioning. And because it does pass through your body, there is a notion that perhaps this is operating chemically rather than magically. It might be operating through pheromones, but maybe not.
Maybe both.
Or maybe both.
The magic of E. coli?
The magic of E. coli, yes. Interestingly enough, speaking of E. coli, one hoodoo herb is centipods, which are used in X-Lax. And you use this herb to create a sense of urgency in sexual union, interestingly enough.
Sense of urgency, you say.
Yes. Alright, if you take catnip with raspberry leaf as a tea and you wash your armpits with it, and you put this water in a man's food, he will fall in love with you. That's for women. Soak catnip in whiskey or Kananga water and sprinkle it on your doorstep for 21 days, and you burn one knob on a 7-knob candle with the name of the person on each knob, and you do these 7-knob candles 3 times, so it's 21 knobs. And that person will eventually come to you at the end of the 21-day cycle. Here's a mojo bag for seduction. You take a personal concern. What is a personal concern? Fingernail or toenail pairings, blood, hair, semen, vaginal secretions. You can sometimes use business cards, signatures, and photographs, but it's less strong. The strongest personal concern, the strongest relic or usia, comes from the body of the subject. You put that in a mojo bag, along with coriander, tonka beans, usually 3, rose petals, and the name paper of the subject, which is the name written out. And a man carrying a deer's tongue inside a red silk bag, inside a red flannel bag, will be able to talk women into marrying him. Here's one of the meanest and most infamous love spells in hoodoo, called the Love Me or Die Jackball. And I'll explain why it's used at the end. This is the most coercive love spells. I do not recommend this. I'm telling you this because it's famous and it exists, and it's to make a point. All right, you take your hair and the hair of your intended, and you put it in a slit in a John the Conqueror root, if the subject is male, and you do an Orus root if it's female. You pack it in, the hair, with Love Me sachet powder and goofer dust. Goofer dust is used for curses, deadly curses. You take a petition paper with the name in black of the subject 7 times, cross with Love Me or Die in red 7 times. And you wet the paper with your urine, and you wrap it tightly around the root, like papier mache. and you wrap around it new red thread, and you tie it off 7 times, and you leave a bit of string to dangle the ball, and you spin it around and say, John Smith, love me or die. John Smith, love me or die. John Smith, love me or die. You do that as long as you can, and you feed it weekly with your urine. And the idea here is that the subject of this will become sick, will not be unable to keep down their food until they have positive thoughts towards you, and it sort of teaches them through behaviorism magically that they should come to you to feel better, and if they push themselves away from you, if they resist you, they will sicken. And if they will either come to you or they will literally die. It is a killing spell. Now here's the thing. This spell is most often used for deadbeat dads. This is used destructively, but in an appropriate moral context. When you see these coercive love spells, you have to understand that they are often in the context of extreme conditions. And I don't want to be judgmental because I don't know the sorts of situations of everybody who's using these sorts of things. Some people may be abusing them terribly, but some of them maybe have unique situations where they're appropriate. And I'm not someone who feels it's appropriate for me to judge because I do curses. I do real curses. I do deadly curses. And I don't want to judge somebody because they want more love in their lives and they're willing to do what it takes to get that there because everybody deserves some love. All right, you bathe your genitals and face in lavage root and carry the water to the crossroads for 9 days before sunrise and pour it out while calling the name of your intended to you. They will come to you. You can take mandrake root, which is a root which sort of looks like a human being, and you bind it to a name paper, and this is used as a doll baby or an effigy for love and hoodoo. Now you take menstrual blood or vaginal juices, pubic hair or semen, you put it into the food, and this will seduce the target pretty much like the bean and corn spells. But this is especially strong with menstrual blood. Now, one popular rendition of this is to put menstrual blood in tomato sauce and pasta and feed that to the subject. The use of menstrual blood in seduction magic goes back thousands of years. I assume it works. Now, here's another hoodoo spell. It's a little more complicated. If you obtain all 10 of your girlfriend's toenail clippings and put them in a bag with 3 black eyed peas and hair from her right armpit, how would you get that? And if you carry that for 2 weeks, she will marry you.
While they sleep, apparently.
Probably, yeah. They sleep pretty deeply. All right. In Sappho's hymn to Aphrodite, Sappho implores that the heart of a certain woman will burn even despite her will. So the idea of appealing to divinity to help facilitate the seduction of a particular person goes back even to the times of ancient Greece and probably much earlier. Now the next spell, and I think a bunch of the next spells are actually ancient Jewish love spells. This is something I recently discovered as I began to read about alternatives to Kabbalah in the Jewish tradition. If you take the blood of two members of a couple, if you take the blood of a couple and you put it in an empty eggshell and you write their names on it and you seal it with wax and you bury it in the ground like a seed to make them love each other. If you write the names of a couple on wet clay and you throw it into a furnace, you say, as this clay burns, so shall the hearts of these burn for each other. It's also Jewish love magic. If you write your intended's name in your blood on a new oil lamp and you keep it burning indefinitely, the person you desire will come unto you and be yours. There was also a Jewish incantation for love, which I found, which was quite unusual. There are no other elements, it's just an incantation. I adjure you, Ashafiel, Shufriel, Cupido, to place a fierce love between X and Y, amen. What's interesting in this instance is Cupido is not a Jewish angel. It's Cupid from the Roman tradition. How that got inserted into the Jewish tradition, which is so avoidant of idolatry and foreign gods, is beyond me. But it's interesting to see that cross-pollination did take place.
Could it have taken place during the time that the Rome, Roman Empire had.
Well, it would have had to have been. Yeah. And this was from probably the interior to the Greek magical papyri. But I suppose the boundaries of what was considered to be Jewish practice at that point was more flexible than it is today. Now, some ancient Greek love effigies put 13 pins into the poppet to cause discomfort until the desired sought relief, very similar to the Love Me or Die Jack ball. And worst of all, and I really, really mean it, don't ever do anything like this, the ancient Greeks would use live animal effigies. And they would take songbirds and they would torment the songbird to make it scream as a way of tormenting the soul of their intended so that they would come unto them. Don't even think about doing this one. I'm mentioning that because A, the Greeks are pretty hardcore, and B, because this logic does go to a really crazy zone. You should also know that the original Greek depictions of the god Eros carried a bow and an arrow, but also a flaming torch and a whip. Passion and love are dangerous, and so can be love magic if applied ruthlessly. Do not give up your soul to gain the object of your heart's affection. Now, the third, fourth, and fifth pentacles of Venus in the Greater Key of Solomon seduce an intended. The third and the fifth must be shown to the intended in order to work upon them. Most talismans and most traditions have to be hidden. Some of the pentacles of Solomon actually have to be shown to the intended in order to seduce them. Now, there's another spell in Picatrix, which I've never tried, but I'm really curious about. It uses amicable numbers, which is a product of the Pythagorean tradition. And the way it works, you take a loaf of bread, here's one example of how to manifest it, and you write the number 284 on one part and 220 on the other. Right, and you eat the larger sum, the 284, and your target eats the 220. An alternate way to do this is to put 284 poppy seeds in one and 220 poppy seeds in the other, or chocolate chips or something like that. And the idea is that the sacred mathematics will allow you to have dominance over the person that you desire. But it doesn't actually have to be 284 and 220 things. You can actually write it invisibly in honey or in a glaze on top of a donut or whatever else that you're using. Here's another spell. If you take your unwashed underwear or socks and you strain whiskey through it, he or she who drinks it will fall in love with you. All right, passion. Herbs for passion: ginger, damiana, cubeb peppers, and lavage. Spells for keeping: these are herbs in hoodoo which are used for love domination. Calamus, licorice, master of the woods, which is sweet woodruff, and witchgrass. Here are some fidelity herbs: raspberry, coriander, cumin, periwinkle, chickweed, and magnolia, and vetiver, which is sometimes used in woods cologne to anoint yourself and your bed. Denise Alvarado has a fidelity floor wash for your bedroom. You take 9 magnolia leaves, and 1 magnolia blossom, brown sugar, and Florida water, and you put it in a bucket of rainwater or river water, and you sweep inward towards your bed, and that keeps the marriage intact. This is a spell from Zora Neale Hurston with slight modifications. You take a sock from a straying husband and write his name on a paper 3 times, and you roll the paper into the sock towards you, and you fold it around a male lodestone with iron filings and a mercury dime with his hair. And you roll this back towards the toe, and you soak it with whiskey, and you nail it above the door, and he will stray no more. Now, if you cut your pubic hair and mix it with hair from your lover's head and put it in your left shoe, you will dominate them. You will have power over them. You will stand on top of them. Literally. If you take 5 pairs of Balm of Gilead buds in a quincunx pattern in your bedroom, it will end sexual incompatibility and strife. If you bind red pakun root and pink pakun root and red flannel, and you anoint it with love me oil, you sew this into your mattress and it makes a couple happy for as long as it stays. If you wrap a lover's photo around a piece of cherry wood, it elicits passion. But if you burn it, that person cannot have sex with another ever again.
Harsh.
Pretty harsh. things get pretty harsh with love magic. People are intense.
I'll have no fury.
Mm-hmm.
Be careful what you wish for.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's always furious.
If you take 9 of your girlfriend's fingernail clippings and 9 of her toenail clippings and 9 hairs from her head, and you put this in a hollowed out onion with sugar, and you close it up, you bury this outside the east of your home at sunrise to keep the relationship intact. This is a binding upon her to sweeten the onion, to sweeten that which is soured and bitter. If a woman rubs a man's hat over her genitals, he will always have her on his mind. That's pretty literal.
But, and probably from a time where men wore hats rather continuously.
Yeah, indeed. I miss those times. Just for the hats. Just for the hats.
Just for the Doras are pretty
awesome. Yeah. Okay, you trim all 10 of your fingernails and you put them into wine and you strain the wine, you give it to your lover to drink, and that person will always be under your control, under your hands, under your fists. Here's one of the nastier ones that I found. I love the nasty ones. This is a spell how to cheat without your lover leaving you. You take a mojo bag full of broken pins and needles and tobacco snuff, sugar, and your spouse's pubic hairs, and you wear this next to your skin. And the broken pins and needles represent the broken vows that you've made to her or him. I don't do anything like that, but it's pretty intense, the symbolism. Now, if you write the names of newlyweds, both of the names, on onion honey, on 2 different leaves of sage, they should eat them immediately after leaving the wedding canopy. This is from the Jewish tradition, so there's a wedding canopy. And they will be faithful, love each other for the rest of their lives. Now, this is another Jewish spell. If you take an egg that was laid that very day, and you pass it thrice over a woman's right leg, and you boil it, and you peel it, and you cover it with honey and flour, when her partner eats it, they'll be unable to have sex with any other person. Breakup spells.
The Jewish tradition seems very intent on egg symbolism.
Yes, it is. It's really fascinating. This is a new discovery of mine. I actually have been doing Jewish folk magic since I was a kid, because I grew up an Orthodox Jew, and I've been doing egg magic by way of Santeria, and I've been combining them without realizing this was a part of an ancient tradition. So I guess maybe there is something in the blood.
Well, the concept of the spiritual egg goes way back, way, way back.
Oh, yeah. I think it's pretty cool. All right, this is the most benign breakup spell, but we won't stay there. The most benign breakup spell uses you take lemon balm and it clears away a bad love and heartbreak and replaces it with a new love. That's nice. This is not so much nice. To rid yourself of a lover, you put their hair in a bottle and you throw it into a river, and as it passes out to the sea, that person will go far away.
Hair in a bottle.
Hair in a bottle. Like a message in a bottle, but their hair.
It's gotta be hair, not hair.
This is a really classic one. You see the theme of black dog hair and black cat hair over and over again. This is a bottle spell involving that. You take the black dog hair, the black cat hair, the personal concerns of the couple, and 9 pins, 9 coffin nails, and 9 needles, and you fill it to the top of the urine. And you seal it with black wax, and you bury it under their front doorstep if you can, and close to the doorstep if you can't. And every time they walk over it, they will begin to start hating each other like cats and dogs hate each other and start fighting, and the relationship will end.
Cats and dogs don't really hate each other.
It's a myth, but it's a recurrent myth. Now, if you take a black candle and you dress it with confusion oil, you take a halved lemon, and okay, this is like the apple spell, but the opposite. You take a name paper with one of the person's names in a mirror script and one direct, and you write it on the same paper, and you cut that paper in half, symbolizing division between lovers, and you put them back to back in the split lemon, and you seal the lemon with black wax. And you put black cat hair again and black dog hair in it with red peppers to make it really an intense fighting. And you seal it with a black wax and you bury it in the yard of your target, and that will end their relationship. Now, there are spells which force people to marry you. This is how you prevent that. To stop a marriage forcing spell, you wrap some of your hair around a nail and you drive it into a sweet gum tree. This is hoodoo. And you go back exactly the way you came. You trace your footsteps backwards. Now, you boil 9 English walnuts in 3 quarts of water and reduce it to 1 quart and bathe in this. And you throw the leftovers at a tree or at the crossroads while renouncing your love, and you will fall out of love with that person. And if you cut up a lemon and you put the little pieces of lemon in the tracks of someone you want to go away, they will be gone. This is to end stalkers. Now, this is another one which is maybe not terribly safe, but is mentioned for historical reasons. If you boil an egg in the urine of a virgin, and you give half of the egg to a dog to eat and half to a cat to eat, you write the names on the egg before you do this, and you say, as you are separating into enemies with this egg, so must these lovers separate. Last bit, reconciliation. Damiana brings back a lost lover. On a petition paper, you cross your name 9 times with your lover's name 9 times, and you put it on a white saucer full of sugar, and you burn a white candle for each of 9 days, and if they've not returned by then, you have to give up. Reconciliation spells are the most difficult type of love spell. They almost never work. So you have to create a cutoff point for yourself and allow yourself to move on. That's the end of the material, and it's time for the questions. What questions do you have? Yes, most protective magic against curses will also work against coercive love spells. One of the things that is done in hoodoo, for example, is you comb graveyard dirt through your hair if they took the hair off of you, and this is a way of canceling out using the power of death in the cemetery.
I guess it's not so much a question, but I know you had said earlier that you've done curses and things, and you're like, no judgment.
I don't know people's individual circumstances. But I do urge people to be circumspect in their dealings with this type of magic, because in its worst manifestations, it's brain rape.
And that was basically what I was going to say. I was like, it's fucking with free will. So that was my only question is, I was always urged to be very cautious of things like this, and
be very cautious.
Yeah.
But I don't know all of your circumstances, and I won't judge you. I don't know your situation. There are gray areas. There are times where a harder push is more appropriate. But the reason why the larger body of literature of love magic is coercive, and it is because for the majority of history, people had very little freedom. And the idea of being able to choose your lover was abnormal. And so, to a certain extent, what I'm describing to you here is for a historical reference and not to be used except under more unusual circumstances.
And sometimes people have epic boundary issues that they need to break through. While it's not exactly the nicest thing to do, sometimes it's also necessary.
Exactly. Next.
What about if somebody's like, you're in a relationship with somebody, but they've been really hurt before and they're kind of nervous about maybe taking it further or whatnot, like, is there...
Well, the spells which are used to make someone marry you can also be used to allow a relationship to be more committed and to progress. Also, spells which relate to the increase of passion also will move things in that direction.
Less of a shove and more of a nudge.
Yeah, you can use a honey jar for that one. You can sweeten someone towards a notion or a person.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Okay.
I'm fine.
Is there something that people do together to strengthen bonds? Like,
absolutely.
Well, sex magic?
Right. I mentioned a spell which say with sage leaves, which newlyweds will eat after leaving the kuppah in Jewish religion, or the blood of two members of the blood of a couple, which is put into an egg. We assume they do this voluntarily to bless their relationship. Maybe not, but it's hard to get blood from 2 different people without, anyway. But yeah, another way of working that is the spells which involve sewing things into mattresses for a couple, Another way of doing this would be a honey jar spell, if you're really familiar with the concept. You have two relics from two people, you put it in a jar, filled it up with honey or some other sweetening agent, and you burn a candle on it every week on Friday to represent love, and that will keep the sweetness between the two going. This can be used by a couple or an individual to warm someone's feelings towards you, but definitely couples do that.
Do you have any experience with anything that would work for the least stressful breakup? Like, I know it's going to be hell on earth from his point of view, at least for a few minutes, I'm hoping, or a few years.
I gave a number of spells which can be used to ease heartache and to end romantic feelings. Yeah. Those can be used on you, but they can also be used sneakily on the other person.
Right. Is there something you could add to it to kind of add a flavor of sweetness?
Absolutely, and I've done that before. One of the times I've used a coercive love spell was to make a breakup less drama prone. But you would mostly use sweetening agents for that, sugar, honey, and to create warm feelings, but not too warm. Add a little bit of lemon balm and things like that into the mix along with the sweetness. Question?
Sometimes you're pretty reluctant to open yourself up to more loving emotions. Is there something you can do to make yourself more accessible to...
This is not in any of the old literature, but what I would do is I would create a wax effigy of a heart, write my name on it, and make it into a candle and melt my own heart. Another thing that I might do is the Rose Cross ritual, which I illustrated in the wards class yesterday, and that draws the energy of Tefar, the heart chakra, and that will open you up to more affectionate relations with other people.
Because I know most of this is more about the attraction of another mate rather than making yourself more open to such things, but
yes.
That's the other side of this issue.
Certainly. I agree. More?
Look, with regard to the coercive side of this, what happens if you do one of these coercive spells and it works? Is there a time frame in which that's going to wear off? Do you have to keep reinitiating the spell? Because I have heard it said that in the past that if you do something like this, eventually you're going to have to just keep pouring energy into it in order to keep the person on the hook, as it were.
That is one of the most intriguing questions, and there's a complicated answer, and is that it depends. It depends upon the magical tradition, a lot of interpretations of the tradition. There are many legends of hoodoo root workers who die, and all the spells that they did just go with them when they die, and all the love spells they've done just puff in a puff of smoke. There are also talismans which last 1,000 years, and their love spells will last beyond human lifespans. It may depend upon where the source of the power comes from. If it comes from a magician's power and the magician dies, the spell itself is mortal. It must be renewed. If it comes from an external power source, like the planets or angels or God or gods, then that can last forever because those powers may last forever. What may need to be renewed or may not need to be renewed is the connection between the spell and that higher power. So it depends. Next question. All right, I hope you enjoyed yourself and learned a little bit. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.